find that it was very, very pleased, and it's been a great experience for all. So I'm not going to talk a lot. I just want to thank you for coming, and it's going to be a very interesting program. So
thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Thanks for inviting us to present this exciting subject. Double excited because it's Diego Rivera, the greatest Latin American artist of his time, of the 20th century, and the greatest Mayan book, the Popol Vuh. So we always like to set up the ambience, the environment with music from the region of we are playing. In this case, Javier and I were going to start with a song from Yucatán, La Tierra de Mi Suegro, right? I think if you see some tears from my husband, it's because his father used to love this song that is called Caminante del Mayab. So this is a song from Yucatán, and it belongs to the Mayan culture. Caminante del Mayab.
Caminante. Caminante, que vas por los
rustle, nothing move, nothing made the least sound. They who existed in the heart of heavens were Huracán and Gugumats, lightning flash and clap of thunder, and green feather serpent. High over the sea they hovered, enveloped in a green and azure light. In them was the greatest wisdom.
rising like lobsters out of the sea. In the same way, valleys were formed with the streams going serpent-like among them.
And you can just stop over there.
Yeah, okay. So I think that you can see the similarities with the Genesis, those of you who have read it, okay? But let me point out two important differences. Because if it were just a copy of the Genesis, then it wouldn't have a value as the value we give to this book today, okay? There are very, very important differences. And one of them is very obvious. In Genesis, one God creates everything. Jehovah. Jehovah was saying in Spanish, right? He is the creator of everything. He is not a company. And what happens in the Popolo is a group of gods that decide to create trees, mountains. There are two gods in particular. So you see the polytheistic vision. There are two gods. The first one, the one that you cannot see over there, is is Kukulkan. It has many names. For the Aztecs, it was Quetzalcoatl. The Mayans call it Kukulkan or Gucumatz, the feathered serpent, la serpiente emplumada. So see how the serpent had for the Mayans a divine, a very powerful meaning. Not for the Catholics. For the Catholics, what was the serpent?
The devil.
The evil. So you see how a symbol, and this is just an example, how a symbol was an animal, was seen very differently from the Mayans than from the Spaniards. So there are two main gods in charge of the creation, the feathered serpent, Gucumatz, and Huracán. Okay, so when they say, let's separate the earth from the waters, and then they create the mountains and all the animals. The first thing they create are the animals. What do you think happened with the animals? No. It's okay that it's Halloween. That's a more interesting story, okay? But the animals, the gods want the animals to give them respect, to recognize that they are their gods, okay? They want the animals to praise them. But the animals cannot talk. They can only make sounds. So they are not as the gods expected. Okay? And in a way, they condemn the animals to live. The Popol Vuh is very, very complex. And there is a reason why the rabbit doesn't have a tail, and there is a reason for everything, because remember, this is a book that they created over centuries about what was their belief regarding the creation and the creation of every single animal. So everything is in the Popol Vuh. It's a very, very complex, but a very rich book. So they created the animals, but the animals could not praise their gods, could not recognize their creators. So they decide to make a man. Out of what? If you can. Yes. Oh no, the next. Out of clay. Okay, so they create, the first men are created out of clay, according to the Popol Vuh. We know we might not agree, but it's what they believe. But these men are weak. They cannot move. And they dissolve. As you can see, and this is a representation that Diego Rivera did of the clay man. So you can see that the gods are creating together. That's something that I like about, I mean, these are gods that are not perfect. These are gods that kind of play, experiment. Okay, let's do this. These are gods that, hey, help me with this. I need your help, okay? And more gods like this, and elderly. There are two elderly people. We must remember that very old people were considered very, very wise. I mean, how beautiful, no? For all Mesoamerican cultures, they have certain rights because they were senior citizens, like my husband. Just kidding. No, it's because yesterday was his birthday, so.
Happy birthday! Okay.
They created the man, and it was a failure. This man could talk, but they could not think. They could not move, and they dissolved. Now, something interesting about the Popol Vuh is that you can read it as a metaphor. Because the next creation, if you go to the next, they created a man out of wood. And contrary to the previous one, these were a little bit better. They were sturdy, estaban duros, but maybe too much. Very hard feelings. They reproduced, but they didn't recognize their creator either. They were not appreciative. They were disdainful towards nature. You see, we can even read it as a metaphor of several generations of humankind. And they destroyed, here is another similarity with the Bible. They destroyed the wooden men by a flood, con un diluvio. There is a diluvio to talk about, a diluvio, just as in the Christian Bible. So right here, Diego Rivera, you see very detailed. Some critics consider this the best watercolor. Right here we have a little Chihuahua dog biting one of the foot of these men, because these men were kind of cruel against animals. And there's another one that is over there, a bird that is eating. So the gods allow them to destroy the people made out of wood. And then you would think, okay, if you are reading the Popol Vuh, you say, okay, now let's see. Let's see what is the third creation. But as I said before, they had another way to narrate stories. And there is intercalated the story of the twins, of the twins God, and then of the fathers of the twins. There is a reason for that, okay? But it's like a last and emotion. We don't arrive, okay, what is the third creation? Okay, so we are in the second creation. They destroy the wooden men with a flood, and then, this is funny. The monkeys are supposed to be the descendants of the, because some were a little bit smarter. Some of the wooden men were smarter than the rest, and they climbed the trees and they stayed there. And then eventually they became monkeys. Okay, but you see, they could talk, they could reproduce, but they were not humans. Later on, we have a big correspondence of letters that is in the Smithsonian Museum, that they had problems. According to the writer, the American writer, Mr. Rivera, has failed to finish the promised watercolors, okay? So, and Mr. Rivera keeps asking for more and more money. So there were economical problems, and on top of that, there was a American recession. So unfortunately, during that time, neither of those projects was accomplished. But Diego Rivera did 24 watercolors that later on, after he passed away in the 1990s, his daughter, Guadalupe Marin, she published those, and those are the ones we are using this evening. He managed to finish 24 watercolors to illustrate the Popol Vuh. The Popol Vuh, why is important the Popol Vuh? Well, almost anything that we have of a written testimony of the Indian civilizations before the arrival of the Spanish is important. Why? Because we must remember that when the Spaniards arrived to the Americas, and when I say America, as many of you know, is a continent, not a country, the United States didn't exist in the 16th century. We're talking about the 16th century when the Spaniards arrived. They destroy many things that they consider, many of these books that they consider diabolic. Okay, so they destroy them because remember that it was they want to conquer not only with weapons, but it was also a religious conquest. Okay, so they wanted to implement Christianism. So the Mayans, and in particular, we're talking about the Quiché people. The Quiché people that are located in Guatemala. Any people from Guatemala here? Okay. So the Quiché people are, because there are many Mayan groups, and there are many Mayan groups in different countries of today, like we know that in Mexico, we just opened with a song from Yucatán. So there are Mayan population in Yucatán, in Chiapas, in Quintana Roo, in Campeche, but also in most parts of Central America, in Guatemala, El Salvador, Honduras. The Mayan culture flourished, and different Mayan groups in those countries. So it's of vital importance. The Popol Vuh is one of the most, sometimes we, the historians think that it's a religious book, but it's not only a religious book. It's a book that contains the cosmogony, how the indigenous population saw their creation and the creation of the universe and every and all the animals of the nature that surrounded them. So let me tell you very quickly the history of the Popol Vuh. After the conquest in 1550, when the survivors and the sons and the children of the survivors of the conquest saw that their world was disappearing as they knew it, they wanted to leave a written testimony of their beliefs. And they transcribed. What does it mean, transcribe? It means that from oral tradition, they did a written transcription of this book. The book that in Spanish, in English, would say the book of the council. Okay, the Popol Vuh, that's what it means. The book of the mat, like petate, because the petate had a symbol. It was very symbolic for them. So when they saw that, they wanted to leave a written testimony, so they transcribed first into Mayan, and then later on, a friar in the 17th century, Francisco Jiménez, he did the first translation of Spanish. And amazingly, this translation, right now, I didn't want to connect to the internet, because right there is the, I don't know if you have a connectivity, but if you click, no, but it's okay if you don't. Oh yeah, okay, because if you click over there, because that book is still, is in the, is in Chicago. And in the year 2018, they did a digital transcription of the Popol Vuh. They did it is digital. If you click in the book, I think it takes you over there. But if not, it's amazing when you have a read, but we don't see it here, Daniel. Maybe. Complicate more things, Unapu and Shbalanke. And then we learn everything, all that the gods ask the help of, because these were also semi-gods. And it seemed like they needed their help to finish their creation. So we have the adventures of Unapu and Shbalanke. They come to Earth or to this universe that is in the process of creation, and they defeat several among them. If you have a man out of corn, and that's the man that will become the ancestors of the Quiché people, because we must remember that this is the story, the genealogy of the Quiché people of Guatemala. So we're going to do two more songs, and then you have, we're going to open, I know I went a little bit fast, okay? But okay, so let's
ready?
Undervalued. That's the reality, okay? They don't pay a bilingual person to speak the native language. They pay you, you speak, I'm talking about Mexico and Central America. They pay you if you speak English or French or another language, not if you speak Quiche or any other indigenous language. But in Yucatan, the government of Yucatan and the people of Yucatan are making big efforts to preserve the language because they see that if they don't pass the language to the future generations, the language is going to disappear. And you can see that it's beautiful. So I'm going to sing a song that I just got from the internet for this presentation. It's kind of a children's song, and it says, it's a song that says, Buenos Dias, how to say good morning and to appreciate the creator for everything. And it's easier than the other one. You will be able to clap your hands and to say la la la. Okay, if you don't understand the word, just say la la la. That doesn't. So we're going to do Maloquin, Buenos Dias. This is Mayan from Yucatan, which is very different.
La 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 la. Has tu malo que mascahua lo que es. Has tu malo que intitula cales. Has tu malo que mascahua lo que es. Has tu malo que intitula cales. Has tu malo que mascahua lo que es. Has tu malo que intitula cales. Has tu malo que mascahua lo que es. Yankani huitan. Yankani que. Yankari keistim, why do not he so? Has to pam 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 la 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 la
the children, the younger generations, to preserve the language, and the children are singing this song. So with this, I conclude. Thank you very much. I'm sorry for the pressure to